Welcome, dear viewers, to Couch Warrior TV on YouTube. I'm the Couch Warrior, and you are watching ASHES 2, the Shadeling story. This is the Patreon-only companion story to ASHES. Welcome to Episode 2 of the Shadowbox. Well, at the end of the last episode, we witnessed the Shadeling take care of this bandit camp. And now it's time to move on. But what will the Shadeling do? Let's find out together.
I require more power. I must find power sources. Resides nearby. We shall find it.
Well, the Shadeling, as we discussed in the last episode, is fueled by souls. We really don't understand quite yet how this happened, how he came to be fueled by souls, but what we did witness in the first episode was we saw him basically being very weak. And he acquired a petty soul gem and was able to give himself at least enough energy to launch an attack on the necromancers in Fort Snowhawk. He was able to confiscate a number of soul gems, most of which were empty, but he did find one black soul gem, and that seemed to be enough to power him. To fuel his movement and his magic use. But now he is going to be looking for more power. And that has led him here. So let's see what we can do here. Pretty tough. All right. Took care of her. Thus far, we are undetected. It's still fairly early in the morning. When we emerged from Fort Snowhawk, it was very early in the morning, and we staged our attack on the bandits at Robber's Gorge right away. So we still have a good portion of the day left. Now, for those of you who have watched part two of Marl's story, you get to see the aftermath at Robber's Gorge that the Shadeling leaves behind. That's kind of how these stories are intertwined. It's going to be a little bit tricky going forward. So I'm going to do everything in my power to make sure that you are able to keep track of where you're at if you're watching both stories, that you're able to watch them sequentially.
Hello.
Put her right in here. Alright, so, there is a change in the character since the last episode that I am going to just take a quick moment to explain to you. So, one of the things that is frustrating about unarmed combat is you really do not have the ability to hotkey fists. So, in order for that to work, what I had to actually do was add a dagger to inventory, and then I also added a shield to inventory. And I hotkeyed these to 7 and 8. So, essentially what's going to happen here is if I punch one twice, then the other one twice, okay, I get fists. So, if I do something like I go invisible, and then you hear all that, that's what's going on. Now I'm basically unarmed, right? And I'm ready to go into combat. That's kind of what's going on there. So my intent is not really to use the dagger as a weapon. I'm basically using it more or less as a placeholder that allows me to quickly and efficiently get to unarmed combat. So there is an ebony shield and an ebony dagger that are there as placeholders for that express purpose. I just wanted to explain that to you. I haven't really changed my philosophy in any way on this character being unarmed, but it was just kind of a workaround for that situation. All right, I wonder if we can... I was thinking about dropping the enemy in the trap, but I don't know if that's going to be very reliable, to be honest. What we can do, however, is we can set a trap here. She's quick. Where are you? Here. I want to welcome all of you who are new Patreon subscribers. I know that many of you have subscribed to my Patreon campaign or elected to support my Patreon campaign specifically because you were interested in getting the Shadeling content. And so I am going to strive very hard not to disappoint you. Just in case, for those of you who are new, if you're not aware, as a Patreon supporter, you also have the distinct privilege of being able to submit assassination contracts for the Shadeling. So I want to just kind of clarify how this is designed to work. There's going to be a new series on the channel. I really have... I don't know enough about how I'm going to do it yet to be able to tell you how often it's going to come out. But the purpose of that is to allow Patreon subscribers to submit challenges to the Shadeling. And I have created a parallel profile of this character so that we can find new, interesting, and fun ways to achieve these assassinations. So that is going to be coming out every so often. I will be taking these submissions on the Discord channel, on the Discord server, excuse me. So you can go to discord.charactercrusade.com and you will find a text channel on Discord called the Shadeling's Inbox. If you submit your contract requests there, I will consider possibly doing them. Now, I've gotten quite a few already, so I'm definitely not going to be able to do everything, but I will endeavor to do as many as I can. Okay, let's put a little surprise here. Okay, now that is angled downward, so that acceleration rune is going to launch an enemy straight down, probably around here. So let's put a surprise down at the bottom. Oh, she already flew down. How about this is for you? Being cagey probably makes sense. All right. Ah, that took care of that. Let's get that. Well, potion is good. Frost rune staff. That is good. Now remember, the items that the Shadeling is taking are items that he envisions being useful tomorrow. So that's kind of what he's thinking about right now. So we're taking money, we're taking small valuables, we're taking certain potions, things like that. Eventually we will see the Shadeling leave these things in places where he thinks Marl will be able to find them. And when I think about his ability to detect magic, I think of it almost as if he has this sort of innate ability to almost smell the presence of magic. And so I'm using the clairvoyance spell to kind of play out that ability. See? It's not foolproof, but... Gotcha. All right.
is power behind this door. Let us investigate.
Right, we've got another staff. That is a good thing. We'll grab the key as well. Let's have a look around. So, we've discussed the idea that the Shadeling kind of uses soul gems almost like batteries. He consumes the power within them. And, uses that to kind of fuel his motion and his own magic. I still have not come up with a good system for tracking that. I've gotten input from many of you, and I do appreciate that. But I haven't arrived at a final decision on how I'm going to track that yet, so I'm still thinking about it. The direction that I'm taking the story may possibly make it a non-issue anyway. So.
This is power. This is not the power I require. We must look elsewhere.
So, soul gems are going to do it, but power that radiates from things like shrines and stuff like that, he can't draw from. One of the ideas that had been the most promising was the idea or the concept of using the Vancian magic perks that are available in Ordinator. What Vancian magic is, basically, is it just gives you sort of a finite number of spells that you can cast in a given day, and which, when you think about it, is ideal, because in essence what that does, right, is it allows you to consume power from some kind of a hidden reservoir, right, and when it's gone, it's gone. However, the Vancian mage perks for Ordinator are not available in SE. They're different in SE. So I'm still working through what's here to see if it's going to actually do the trick for me. I don't know yet. So still working on that. Come on, I gotta get her. Some damage to us there. Gotcha. Okay. I think that about does it. All right. Long stride in the right. And drop zone in the left. Oh, there's one more out there. Where is she, though? Now, I think she's the one that I had deposited way up there on the top, and I don't know if she's still up there or if she's come down. Oh, there we go. That's a dead giveaway, isn't it? Okay, I'm just watching for movement. Let's get some elevation. Yeah, this might be enough. Just need to be able to see up over the top here. I think she keeps going in and out these doors. Sworn warlord. I know you can hear me. Okay, we left a little surprise for her. Remains to be seen if she's going to actually run into it or not. It's going to be a nasty surprise if she does. She's really confused now. That's what the Shadeling's all about, right? Ooh, whoa. Gotcha. We'll just end it. Okay, so let's figure out what our next target is. So the Shadeling is basically, at this point, he's kind of wandering aimlessly. And he's searching for sources of power that he can use to sustain himself. And his objective at the moment, it's really about survival. It's about remaining ambulatory, right? With the loss of power comes the loss of freedom and comes vulnerability. And, you know, a gem is only going to go so far. So he's in the business now of trying to make up enough of these to gain enough power so that he can stay in control of his situation. And so despite his, I guess, dedication to Marl and Marl's situation, he's in a situation now where he's got to think primarily about self-preservation. So, and he's trying to ensure that he doesn't somehow lose his freedom in all of this. Close. Golden lockpicks we take. Courier's letter. I don't think you would have a reason to take that. There are certain things that we will discover that, the Shadeling is just not curious about. I mean, his primary goal is, firstly, making sure that he can maintain his independence. And secondly, making sure that Marl is provided for, essentially. We still don't understand completely what this connection is between Marl and the Shadeling. But we do understand that Marl harbors some sense of responsibility for the Shadeling. We don't know if that's responsibility for the Shadeling's well-being, or some kind of responsibility born of guilt for the Shadeling situation. We just haven't gotten that far down the story track yet to know. But we're working our way there. So it's been really interesting to watch people speculate, not only on what that relationship is, but who the Shadeling is, what the Shadeling is. That's been interesting. Back. Guiding us back to the road. Okay.
We must find the power. We must maintain power for Marl.
Okay, what we're going to do here is the Shadeling is going to avoid going through this town. I think if he had his preference, I think of the Shadeling as a creature that would want to travel at night, but out of necessity, we can't afford that luxury at the moment. Okay, I think this is paralleling the road is what the deal is with this path, so... We're gonna parallel the road and we'll check in every once in a while. So the spell that I'm using to increase travel speed is called Long Stride. Let's head back up to the road to make sure that we haven't gotten completely off track. Oh yeah, we're still good. Excuse me. So obviously the style of this story is very different than what we have been experiencing through Marl's story. Marl's story is probably 90% roleplay. Shadeling's story is going to be the opposite. It's going to be about 90% commentary, 10% roleplay. I always am making decisions in character based on roleplay and story considerations. But it's just a different style of storytelling, and that is intentional because I'm trying to create some variety for myself. That is what's going to keep me enthused about doing this. So a little variety between the two stories I think is good, but they will be connected definitely, so... Okay, the indication of power is leading us here. So the Shadeling will investigate. Okay. Let's do a little recon first. Vampire. Stealth kill. Only takes one rune to finish these guys off, so... Bam. All right, let's go see what we can find here. We need to find the source of the power. Healing potion for Marl. Gold for Marl. Here. Common soul gem. Black soul gem. So, last time we saw that he followed the source of power, and it seemed to be a bit of a red herring, right? It turned out to be power that was emanating from a shrine. So, we know that he does not have the ability to distinguish between types of power at range, and that only certain kinds of power are useful to him. So if we look at it, basically what we found were three empty soul gems, including an empty black soul gem. It stands to reason that maybe if the black soul gem was full, he might have been able to detect that. But they were all empty. So then the question is, what is the source of power here that he was detecting? Was it the vampire himself? A Nightmaster vampire, perhaps? So the Shadeling is a bit confused at the moment about what he was detecting. Illusion 100. So in essence, we're not a lot better off than we were previously. Now, one of the things that we're going to see is I like the idea that the Shadeling is also acquiring enchantments. And for me, this is more than just a game mechanic, you know, for crafting or whatever, but I'm kind of thinking of it as symbolic of him learning. He has this innate ability to sort of absorb and use magical energy. And I feel like the idea of gaining enchantments, you know, basically being able to dissemble what's going on with an item based on looking at it, is kind of a unique idea when you look at it from the perspective of the Shadeling. I'm thinking of it just a different way of looking at acquiring of these enchantments. So I don't know that he's going to do anything with them. We really aren't sure yet what the Shadeling would do. At this point, he's basically got one very simple goal, and that is to stay moving, to keep moving, to stay independent. So we haven't really thought beyond what would a strange character like the Shadeling set out for himself in terms of objectives. We don't know yet. So this is a steel helmet of the Enchanter. Weapon and staff enchantments are 8% better. Doubled on power attack. That's pretty cool. Okay, our enchanting is increasing. That's good. And we've gained a couple of levels here from books, which is pretty good. So, the Shadeling still does not have the power he needs. So that begs the question, what about, mechanically speaking, gathering souls? Well, I've been thinking about that, and I do think that a character that is basically powered by souls would have some ability to gather them as well. But I think traditionally what we do, right, is we put the soul trap enchantment on a weapon, or we use the soul trap spell, which is kind of a targeted spell. You hit the enemy with it, then you kill that enemy, and you've captured their soul. That seems too intentional. And what I mean by that is, wow, that armor is pretty cool looking, isn't it? Wow, let's take a look at it. This is like I'll finish that thought in a second. This is like amped up. Amped up vampire armor, right? Wow, look how fancy looking it is. I love it. I love it a lot. At the moment, this is who the Shadeling is, however. So we're going to disenchant it. So, let's disenchant this guy. We gain that enchantment. Without having a system in place to sort of monitor how much of the power is he using, I'm just going to sort of play it by ear through role-playing. So, a couple of things here. The first one was the idea of capturing souls. I'm not going to use the traditional soul trap spell, but this is where Apocalypse Spell Package and Anai Sion comes to the rescue once again. He has a spell which is called Soul Cloak. It allows me to put a soul-gathering cloak spell on my character and then just go about his business normally. And what I like about that is it's kind of passive. It sort of gives the idea that the Shadeling has this innate ability to absorb a soul. It's not something that he does intentionally by targeting somebody. He just has this innate ability to absorb a soul. So I like that very much, and we're going to be using that. So he will have the ability to gather souls, but he'll do it using Soul Cloak. The other thing, just kind of finishing a thought, coming back around to this idea of disenchanting weapons. I like the idea that he could grab weapons, armor, items. He could take them to an enchanter's table, and he could disenchant them. And at the same time he's learning the enchantment, he's also absorbing residual magic. He's absorbing magic from the item, which will serve to power him for a while. So I kind of like that idea as well. So that seems like a nice addition to the concept of the character. That is such a cool effect. The combination of the ghost walk and the stealth attack like that. I love the way that it almost looks, it makes it appear as though he has this sort of innate ability to kind of do this ghostly killing attack where he's pummeling the body, but you can't actually see what's happening to the body. You see it. There are some stealth kills that are pretty dramatic, where the victim is, you know, picked up over your head and dropped down on their back, and all these kinds of things. And when you see that happen during the ghost walk kind of displacement effect, it's really pretty stunning. All right, so we were attacked by this bandit. Shadeling is going to go in here. It's time to fill some soul gems. All right, ladies and gentlemen. This is the fun stuff. This is where the Shadeling really excels. Combat. That's where we have fun trying some different things. So we've also got a number of interesting developments that we need to talk about. I took a little bit of a time out after entering this cavern to respec some things based on some ideas that have been floated in various forums and so forth about how to deal with this idea of magic charges from soul gems. I've got a plan at work here, and I have made some updates to accommodate that. We're going to go over it in a second.
I knew I'd find you.
There we go. Ooh, nice. Do some damage. Come on. I need her to do some damage to this person before she goes out. Come on. I can't control her attacks. I can only control the direction she's facing and her travel. There we go. More hits she can get in, the better off we'll be. There we go. All right, we've eliminated two bandits. Ooh, look at that. Somebody's alerted to our presence. Got him. Okay, this is the next chamber over. Yeah, she took some serious damage. All right. This is as good a place for us to have a discussion as any. A couple of things that I want to talk about is I want to talk about this idea of recharging. So one of the things I had mentioned earlier was that one of the viewers, William, thank you for your suggestion, William, was suggesting that I use the option in Ordinator. It's in the alteration tree called Vancian Magic, and what that does is it gives you a pool or a finite number of spells that you can cast per day, and then you can recover your pool of spells by getting rest, and then depending on how you get that rest, you can have more or less. The more quality rest you get, you recover all of those slots. So let's say you could cast 50 spells in a day. If you sleep in a bed, then you can recover all 50 slots. If you sleep on a bedroll out in a campsite or something like that, you recover 25 slots. And then by selecting other perks, you can increase the number of spells you have in your pool, and you can also increase the number of spells in your pool based on, I think it's, I don't know if it's how much magicka you have or something like that. That is how the system worked in Legacy Skyrim. The system is actually different in Special Edition. But after reviewing it, it actually works out very well for the plan that I've got for this character. So let's take a look at this, and I just need to explain how it works so that everybody is aware. Now, when I first reviewed it, I didn't think it was such a good deal, but now I have a better understanding for how it works. So we're using something called innate magic. You no longer use magicka to cast spells, but have 4 spell slots. Spells are 25% more powerful or last 50% longer, depending on the type of spell it is, but consume a spell slot when cast. Now, out of combat, spells recharge one at a time when you do not cast for 10 seconds. All right. So basically what this means is I can cast 4 spells while in combat, and once those 4 spells are done, I can't cast any more spells until I'm out of combat, and then my 4 slots recharge. All right. So on the surface, that doesn't look too good, but when you partner that up with Chosen One, now we can choose a gift. We can increase the number of spell slots we have to 7, or we can say that our slots regenerate in combat, or we can say healing spells are 20% more powerful when you have spell slots remaining. I opted for spell slots regenerate in combat, okay? So I still have only 4 spell slots, but the availability of my spells are, it's basically those slots are regenerating, even in combat, every 10 seconds. And then we have Warrior Prophet. When you have no innate magic spell slots remaining, your attack damage and critical strike damage is increased by 20%. These 3 perks, when combined with this, the selection of the regeneration in combat, are actually absolutely perfect for Shadeling's fighting style. So innate magic, basically we've got four slots. It doesn't sound like a great deal on the surface, especially given how many spells that we see this character casting. However, when we partner that up with Chosen One, I opted to go with regenerating in combat as opposed to more spell slots because of our style of combat. Frequently, our style of combat is cast a spell and do something else, or sit back and watch that spell have effect and then react to the situation. So during those downtimes when we're keeping ourselves out of sight, or we're moving in invisible mode from one place to another doing scouting, we're regenerating these spells, okay? So to me, that was a much, much more desirable choice. It makes absolute sense because we have seen a lot of spell casting, but we've also seen a lot of stealth work in between. And then the Warrior Prophet one is really great. So when we get in really dire straits, when we're mixing it up, we've used up all of our spells, we're surrounded, and we're going to hand-to-hand combat, we're going to get this 20% increase in attack damage and critical strike damage when we really need it. So this is kind of a fallback. We've run out of spells and we're going into combat, and now we get that boost that we need in order to really make things happen. So the Warrior Prophet option is not going to come into effect a lot. It shouldn't if we're planning well, all right? But when we need it, it's there in those desperate situations. So to me, this works out really well. And what we've been talking about up to this point was the idea of soul gems actually acting as batteries, right? So we drain a soul gem and then we discard it, right? Well, ultimately, what I really want to do with this character is I want to create a situation where he operates more as if he's got a rechargeable battery, as opposed to a battery that is just thrown away once it's done. So one of my goals from a story perspective is to have the Shadeling pursue Azura's star. And the idea would be that he would use Azura's star as sort of a semi-permanent rechargeable power source, which fits perfectly with this concept of innate magic as it's laid out, right? We've got four spells, slots, but they're recharging every 10 seconds as we use them. It forces us to think about spell selection and economy, and it fits perfectly with the idea of a character who has rechargeable power, but its capacity is limited. So we have to take into account, when we're thinking about our combat strategy, how we want to use our spells and how much time we need in between. It's going to be one more factor that will come into play when we're working out our combat strategies, which adds an additional element of interest for me. So I think this is going to be really great. The other thing that I wanted to talk about real quickly is this character type related to damage output. I had talked about the idea that he was a specialist in frost magic, and this is really important to understand just to what extent to the great extent to which he can do damage. It's pretty remarkable when you think about it, because so many things are stacking here. So just destruction mastery, two levels of destruction mastery, okay? These are going to give us this bonus of 0.5% more powerful per level of destruction. And we are currently at 93 destruction level. Okay, dual casting. We're using dual casting to increase the power of our spell. This doesn't tell us exactly how much power we're adding, but we know that there is additional power being added. Now, force of nature. This is just giving us kind of some economy, right? 30% less cost when we're casting these in favorable weather. So if we're casting our frost spells and we are up near Dawnstar somewhere, we're going to get much more economy out of these spells, which makes a lot of sense. But when it comes to damage output, it's elemental specialization that I had mentioned before. This is where we really see some significant improvement. So I had selected frost as the preferred spell. Spells and effects of that element are 15% more powerful. Okay. Now, this means that the other elements are 15% weaker, which I think is a nice trade-off. So if you ever see the Shadeling casting shock or flame spells, something is terribly wrong. We are very, very specialized. Then we come over here to this track. Now, this is the Frost spell track, which starts with Merciless Cold. We've got two levels in that, which are going to amp up the damage by 50%. All right? And then we've got a number of other effects, including Frostfall, Crystallize, Hypothermia, Exhaust, all right, and Winter's Majesty. And what these do, for the most part, is they affect the armor rating of our opponents. So as opposed to just increasing damage, we're now damaging the armor rating of our opponents, and we're also attacking their stamina and their ability to regenerate stamina. So while these perks don't amp up damage per se, what they're doing is they reduce the attack damage of our enemies, reduce their ability to protect themselves, and slow them down. So all of those combined are really important. Now, when we're talking about damage output, that also is going to be affected by our sneak skill, which for the Shadeling is a legendary skill. All right, so we've got Sneak Mastery. We're starting out with a Sneak Mastery, and this is just about our effectiveness when it comes to sneaking. But where we really nail it here is the Sneak Attack. So, Sneak Attacks with one-handed weapons deal 100% more damage. That doesn't apply to us because we're unarmed, but Sneak Attacks with any other weapons or fists deal 25% more damage. That's great for us. Problem Solver. Sneak attacks deal 10% more damage for each 200 points of health the target has, up to 50%. So this allows us for scaling increases, scalable increases in damage based on the difficulty of our opponents, which makes this nice. It's a viable perk. It's just as viable, you know, at first level as it is at 50th level. Cloak and Dagger, breaking invisibility with a power attack is guaranteed a critical strike. So, this is where we see a huge increase in damage when we're using our Frost Nova to detonate opponents. So, when we're in stealth and we're using, you know, Ghost Walk, we're completely in sneak mode, and then we're detonating, we're getting that huge 50% bonus, because that's a power attack. We're charging that up, essentially, when we do that. All right? And then we've got a few other things here. Demolition Job, all destruction spells and scrolls are 3% more powerful per sneak level if the target is not detecting the caster. So this, again, gives us a nice bonus. It's a nice reward for staying in stealth. And that's what I was talking about in the last episode, where I feel like Ordinator really opens things up. It makes it a lot more interesting, fun, and viable to be a spell-casting assassin of all types. Now, you don't have to just be a Nightblade, right? You can do a lot of different things. You can mix these perks up in all kinds of different ways to create any kind of assassin you can imagine, which is pretty great in my view. So, just wanted to kind of let you know what's going on with damage output, because this character is really... And his story, as we're progressing through, is really all about combat, combinations of spells, and the unique things we can do with it. It's helpful for you to understand the mechanics of this as we're going along. So, let's continue. All right, we got a guy up there. I want to get up to that second level. But if we're going to go to that second level, I want to kill that guy who's up there. Should we try to bring them in? Hey, I'm here. Come and check me out. See, our innate magic is fully recharged. Even though we're in combat, it's recharging. She's definitely not going to come down here. See me? Okay, so here's what we're going to do. We'll see if she's still in the hallway, if she is. That is not working for us. Come on down here. What are you waiting for, you chicken shits? How can I pay if you won't come down here and make me pay? Interesting. Okay. Well, we can definitely ruin their day by hitting them with some evil twin. Now, let's experiment with this. Let's see if... I'm wondering if we have to have them in view for this to work, or if it's a radius. Oh, yeah. That hallway is going to become very uncomfortable. Now, what's brilliant about this is because we're using innate magic, look at below, there is no magicka bar. I can literally use this spell as long as I can hold it. Now again, I've only got 4 spell slots. That doesn't matter. And what I like about this is I think it fits the character as well, in that we're kind of treating the Shadeling as if he were a magical creature who has these innate abilities, right? So innate magic makes a lot of sense. So let's keep holding it and see what happens. Let's get right in here.
There's someone there.
Yep. Still going. As long as my finger doesn't get tired. Now this guy, we gotta get him busy. I'm gonna get closer to him and see if we can... If we spawn a twin for him, we would conceivably have a mage, I would think. Okay, that's not working for us. Okay, we're gonna deal with him in our own way. We're gonna escape this guy. Haha. Ooh.
Where are you?
Alright, so you can kind of get a sense now for how this damage output is pretty amazing. Yes, we're completely focused, we're limiting ourselves, but we're being rewarded in exchange. Okay, let's let this... We're gonna let this spell run its course. Alright, innate magic fully charged. Alright, so we got all 4 spell slots. Now, there was never a point during that combat where I felt like I was missing out on anything, like I was strapped in any way. So once you kind of understand how the mechanic works, you can kind of play to it, which... makes perfect sense. And I love the enhanced sense I get of the Shadeling kind of being the equivalent of a magical creature, which I think is super fun. Okay, so let's see, we've got some guys in here. Here's a great example of damage output at work. So what we're gonna do is we're going to dual cast a Frostcloak spell. This is going to last a long time and increase damage output. Okay. Now we're going to go hand to hand. Look at that. They're taking damage from my frost cloak at the same time that I'm pounding their asses. Nice. The Shadeling means business. And what I love about it is not just how it works, but how it makes me feel when I'm playing the character, right? It's kind of like he's this deadly cool breeze, you know? You feel the cool breeze on the back of your neck, and the next thing you know, then your neck's both broken, right? It's just, it to me, it sort of adds to the whole persona of the character. Okay, so the bandit chief came through here. We're on his trail now. And so, when I think about, for example, here, we're taking another break again. Bear with me. These are all roleplay things that I do, and it's worth sharing them with you because you might want to use them as well. I think about every aspect of the character. Why does he walk on water? Yes, that's an innate ability that I'm saying that he has, the ability to walk on water. But when I think through it in my head, I think because he is this magical creature of deadly cold, I sort of envision the water momentarily freezing under his feet. And so as he walks across the water, he's walking across these tiny platforms of ice that are shaped just like his feet. It has the effect of him walking across water, right? And it, again, in my mind, it adds to the mythos of the character and makes playing him that much more interesting. Okay, so actually fighting while walking on water is a little bit difficult because your opponents are below, so quite often you can't hit certain kinds of attacks. So I try to avoid it when necessary. So in this case, we want to get up and out of here. Didn't work at all. Oh, and that's why. Because my shield is equipped. And I can't see the damn thing. Alright. So, let's try something else. Alright, we've got to be very careful. We cast this in the corridor. We got to break the spell. Here he is. Let's get him. Got to survive long enough to catch him. There, we got him. Okay, now. He's going to go back. He's going to do some dirty work for us. Go survey the situation. All right, here we go. Okay, this is a guy that helped us out temporarily, but that's only because we instructed him to. We don't want him to survive ultimately. So, he's good you know, where we're concerned, he's good now, but he'll snap out of it and that rune is going to kill him later. So, no witnesses, right? All right. Let's double check. All right, this is the exit. And this guy, we took care of him earlier. He jumped down and then we snagged him and hit him with the frost rune. All right, so there's some loot back here where the bandit chief is. We're going to go back and just double check. Now, at no point during that entire, during this entire dungeon sequence did I feel like I was hurting for magic. So I think that's good. So, you know, he's considered an ally, so my frost rune spell is not going to work on him until he snaps out of it. Which means we're free to go in here and loot, do whatever we need to do. So, I'm curious to see what's going to happen here. I don't know how long we have to wait. Really no way to tell. All right, just as an experiment, let's see if we can advance by an hour. Runes are still there. He should still be here as well. There he is. And done. Just as planned. So if we had just walked straight out the door, he would have been done for. Good to know. Good to know. That's going to help us out, I think, mechanically, but also from a roleplay perspective going forward. Interesting to note as well, you know, we waited an hour and our runes were still there. So presumably they would stay there for a very long time until we recast. If we, there's only a certain number of runes that we can use at a time. I think with Runecaster, we're topping out at, I want to say, three, I believe. So I could have cast, you know, another single rune maybe, and then it would have gone away. So finite number of runes, which is fine. That makes sense. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I have laid a ton of knowledge on you today about this character. I want to thank you very much for watching this video. So if you are interested in getting involved in our Discord community, please feel free to do that. You can go to discord.charactercrusade.com. There you will also find the text conversation channel called Shadeling's Inbox. If you're interested in submitting an assassination contract for the Shadeling, please feel free to go and check that out. I haven't started making those videos yet. The format is really still in production at this point, so I don't know when those are going to be coming out. I'm working on all the particulars that are required to launch a series for that. So feel free to submit them, and more information will be coming out about when those videos will be available. Those videos, by the way, are going to be available to everyone, but it is only Patreon subscribers that can submit requests for assassinations. So go there. You'll also see a pinned note that'll kind of let you know what questions you need to answer in order to qualify for consideration. So thank you very much for watching this, everybody, and until next time, stay out of the ash.